Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Google Speaks. Secrets of the world's greatest billionaire entrepreneurs, Sergey Brin and Larry Page. By Janet Lowe. Narrated by Sean Pratt. At the 10th birthday of Google Inc., founders Larry Page and Sergey Brin stood on the grounds of Vandenberg Air Force Base in Central California. They watched in wonder as a state-of-the-art Delta II rocket blasted into the atmosphere, carrying a GOI-1 satellite into orbit. The satellite, adorned with the Google logo, would send back razor-sharp photos to be used in the company's popular mapping service. What a glorious way to celebrate the first decade of a company that itself took off like a rocket from its very beginning. Chris Winfield, who heads the search engine ad firm 10E20, noted that in a very short time, Google has become a rage, the equivalent of the Beatles during the 1960s. It's pretty amazing. It's almost like they are in control of the world. The story of the search engine company Google and its two young founders is loaded with superlatives, secrets, and surprises. One thing is certain. The Google guys, Larry and Sergey, both now 36, have become the undisputed lords of all information. In 2006, Time magazine called Google the smartest company of the year and one of the century's most game-changing enterprises. Google was crowned the world's largest search engine and one of the best-known global brands. Praise like that could well go to a company leader's head. The Google founders have been described in many ways, including the Thomas Edisons of the Internet. Brin and Page are the twin princes of high technology who pulled the proverbial sword from the stone. They were groomed for greatness in the computer field from infancy. They traveled to a holy land, Stanford University and Silicon Valley, to prove their mettle in battle. They slew a whole den of dragons and emerged from the quest with flags of victory flying. Their story is a classic hero's journey. Larry and Sergey were accustomed to the role of high achievers. Both are sons of scientists, and both grew up in technology-oriented households. Both were bright and accomplished in school. At Stanford and in Silicon Valley, they were surrounded by a court who knew the landscape of that charmed kingdom. Their professors were among the best in the field of computer science. His brother had already set up a company by the time Larry enrolled at Stanford University, and the brother later sold it to Yahoo. Sergey's father-in-law is a Stanford physics professor. His sister-in-law was a Silicon Valley venture capitalist. Clearly, both men were exceptionally smart and had entrepreneurial personalities, and it was as if they quickly recognized the potential mirrored in one another. They followed their destiny when they developed Google search software, and the community around them, ever alert to the next big idea from techies just barely of legal age, was just waiting for them to step up. To say Sergey and Larry were trained from birth for what they became does not diminish the vast importance or meaning of what they have done. In the 12 years since they first began collaborating on a graduate school project, the Google guys have 1. Started a business in a college dorm room with no more assets than a great idea. 2. Built the largest index of web pages in the world. Google cataloged its trillionth web page in the summer of 2008. 3. Launched with $100,000 private capital and developed into a public corporation with a market capitalization of around $100 million. 4. Expanded from just the two of them to more than 20,000 employees. 5. Grown their company into a giant with a 1.5 million square foot headquarters in Mountain View, California, plus 24 other U.S. offices and technical centers in more than 30 countries. 6. Gathered a customer base, starting with those using a college website, and became one of the most global corporations in existence. 7. Spread from a single service to a web portal with dozens of services and products. 8. dominated the internet search industry, handling more than 70% of all U.S. searches. And 9, developed advertising revenues of around $16 billion a year. This is nearly as much advertising revenue as generated by the four major TV networks combined. Sergey and Larry were ranked as numbers 32 and 33 on Forbes' 2008 list of billionaires, with each of them worth more than $18 billion at the time. They subsequently lost about $6 billion in the value of their Google stock, but they remained fabulously rich. With their fortune came fame. Not so many years after Google debuted, Larry and Sergey visited an Israeli high school for gifted math students. When the pair walked on the stage in the auditorium, they were greeted with a roar, usually reserved for rock stars. Every student there, many of them immigrants like Sergey from the former Soviet Union, knew of Google. And like budding scientists everywhere, many of the students hoped to achieve the same success and status. Despite a distinct nerdiness, their regal demeanors have shone forth in the way they initially marketed their company, as they dealt with venture capitalists, in the way they chose a chief executive officer, in the path by which they took Google public, and later, when dealing with contentious issues such as corporate secrecy, privacy, the intellectual property of others, corporate governance, and new product development. They invariably acted independently and with self-assurance, if not with a good dose of divine right. "There has never been a company," wrote author Ken Aletta, "whose influence extended so far over the media landscape, and which had the ability to disrupt so many existing business models." To survive the economic downturn, Google has hunkered down, prioritizing investments in display advertising, online business software, and mobile telephone ads. Nevertheless, the company remains robust. Page and Brin have become about as powerful as it is possible to be in the high-tech industry, and they have been able to spin that power up to a global level. In Great Britain, the newspaper The Guardian publishes the Media Guardian 100 list, ranking the most powerful individuals in media. The role embraces every sector, including print news, broadcasting, publishing, advertising, and digital media. Larry and Sergey took the top slot. Microsoft's Steve Ballmer was 7th on the list. Yahoo's Jerry Yang, who just months before was still a Silicon Valley celebrity entrepreneur, was not to be found. In order to expand their audience, potential targets for advertising, Google has come up with an astonishing array of products. These include an online classified advertising site, a project to scan every book ever published and put excerpts online, email, instant messaging service, mobile phone software, and so on. Google also sells content, for example, via an online video store selling TV shows, the National Basketball Association games. It's easy to think of advertising simply as an economic activity, albeit a somewhat annoying one to many consumers. But advertising is clearly more than that. "You can tell the ideals of a nation by its advertising," wrote travel writer Norman Douglas in 1917. Even though Google management is locked in on advertising profits, there is time for fun. Google gets a little whimsical with such dreams as building a space elevator that can deliver goods to the moon. Google is more than a place to sneak in a vanity search, learn more about a blind date, or click on ads. Larry Page and Sergey Brin have been the cutting edge of internet search and have managed their leading positions superbly. Even more intriguing is their involvement in so many other front-running technologies. They played a role in 4 of Time magazine's best inventions, including the first and second. First place went to 23andMe, a genetic testing company co-founded by Sergey's wife, Anne. Number 2 was the Tesla green sports car. And 49th was NanoSolar, a solar energy company producing a thin, lightweight, affordable solar panel. Larry and Sergey were early investors in all three companies, and Google itself has invested in 23andMe. The fourth-ranked great invention of 2008 was Google's own idea, wind-powered computer data centers. Google has thousands of engineers working on innovative applications for internet and mobile use. They also are collaborating with the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, to build a high-technology campus at Moffett Field near Google headquarters. Under a 40-year agreement, Google will lease 42.4 acres of bare land from NASA to construct up to 1.2 million square feet of offices and research and development facilities. Google and NASA have begun collaboration on several projects, including one that makes it easier for the scientists to publish planetary data on the Internet. The project has already provided high-resolution lunar imagery and maps to the Google Moon program and resulted in the NASA layer on Google Earth. Similarly, the Global Connection Project enhances the National Geographic layer in Google Earth by embedding geo-referenced stories and images from around the world. The Disaster Response Project develops prototype software tools to help improve first response to large-scale natural disasters. Even the Pentagon sought Google's advice on how better to manage information technology. The founders themselves are generally considered to be good guys, well-intentioned, and doing their best. In their bachelor days, they engaged in what seems like innocent fun. One photo on the web shows Sergey at a fraternity party dressed as a girl. Google is an impressive introduction to the 21st century. By logging onto google.com or one of its numerous other domains, you can locate information in dozens of languages, check real-time stock prices, find phone books for every U.S. city, get directions to your doctor's office, or even check out an aerial or street view of your own house. This company takes us right into the borderless global society. Airplanes and telephones moved us in that direction. Computers are speeding us ever closer. It's also a society that pushes for change, sometimes recklessly. Nevertheless, change is inevitable, and Google is forcing governments to come up with new, equitable guidelines and rules for the internet milieu. Google has a mysterious mojo that isn't easy to explain. Each of the 2008 U.S. presidential candidates trooped to Mountain View to meet with Google and Google employees. Andrew Orlowski, executive editor of the technology website The Register, claims, "The web is a secular religion at the moment, and politicians go to pray at events like the Google Zeitgeist Conference. Any politician who wants to brand himself as a forward-looking person will get himself photographed with the Google boys." Google set off a buzz at both the 2008 Republican and Democratic national conventions. The company sponsored centers for bloggers to report on their observations and insights at both meetings. At the Democratic convention in Denver, Colorado, the bloggers' headquarters was a two-story, 8,000-square-foot facility. Republicans had a similar setup in St. Paul, and more than 200 bloggers registered for credentials there. For the first time since the American Revolution, the potential existed for non-traditional, often non-professional, reporters to control breaking political news. Google's chief executive officer, Eric Schmidt, became an advisor to President Barack Obama's transition team, helping to choose cabinet members for the economy and technology. Additionally, the company has used its huge profits and influence to lobby Congress for advantageous regulatory changes and to compete in new fields, including software, wireless communications, and alternative energy sources. Google's positive image began to shift as the company grew. At first, Google was the miracle of the 21st century. Now, gradually, it's beginning to be seen as a menace. In 2004, Wired magazine plastered pictures of Sergey and Larry on its cover above the title, "Google Mania." 2 years later, it ran another story, headlined, Google phobia. Who's afraid of Sergey? And in parentheses, who isn't? As for this quick switch in attitudes, I find it surprising, said Sergey. Nevertheless, even as the negative noise grew, Google customer satisfaction remained high. One rating service gave Google a score of 86 out of a possible 100. Apple scored 1 point below Google. By comparison, many U.S. airlines ranked somewhere between 54 and 62. Among the questions asked in this audiobook are, 1. What does it mean when a single company becomes our primary portal to the entire World Wide Web? Almost overnight, internet search became the most important tool for finding and processing information. Google has been extremely clever in finding new ways and new information to search. It also has gone beyond search with a web browser, email, and other services. 2. Should individuals be concerned about their privacy in relation to Google or other search engines? What steps can people take to protect themselves? 3. Who owns intellectual property, and who is entitled to use the music, books, art, and other creations to earn money? 4. Has Google become too powerful? And 5. What lies ahead for the company as it matures? Google is just over a decade old, after all. Larry and Sergey always need to be looking behind them, ready for the next youthful entrepreneurs who may be gaining on them. Here are some tips for getting the most out of this audiobook. Remember that Google comes out with advances, new products, and ideas with such speed that it's almost impossible to keep up. For that reason, this audiobook focuses somewhat more on the company and the personalities who created and run Google than its technology. The book is largely based on the words of Larry Page, Sergey Brin, Eric Schmidt, and others at Google. I've also included comments of those who follow the company closely. Thus the title, Google Speaks. Finally, enjoy the audiobook. The saga of Google is one of the most remarkable business tales ever told. Google has a lot to tell us. The Google Guys. Sergey Brin. Sergey was a good boy, his father joked, when he was asleep. Russian roots. Sergey Mikhailovich Brin is the son of a University of Maryland applied probability and statistics professor, his dad, and a NASA scientist, his mom. He was born in Moscow, Russia, on August 21, 1973. Sergey's parents fled to the United States when he was 6 years old, and by the time he was 21, he was on his way to becoming a multicultural marvel. In Moscow, the family, including the parents and Sergey's grandmother, lived in a crowded 350-square-foot apartment. Sergey's toddler playground was a grim courtyard where the boy spent 2 hours a day playing, regardless of how cold the weather. Additionally, the family met with anti-Semitism in the streets and in the workplace. The outlook was so discouraging that the family knew they must leave. When Sergey was 17, they returned to Russia for a visit, despite their nervousness at the reception they might receive. After Sergey saw the crumbling infrastructure and bleak atmosphere of his native Moscow, he felt grateful that his parents had immigrated. I think, if anything, I feel like I have gotten a gift by being in the States rather than growing up in Russia. It just makes me appreciate my life that much more. American Passage. The family, including parents, grandmother, and young Sergey, landed in America on October 25th, 1979. With the help of the Jewish community that sponsored them, Michael and Eugenia Brin found work suitable to their education and settled into a new life in Maryland, just on the perimeter of Washington, D.C. The Brins had not lived a particularly Jewish-centered life in Russia. We felt our Jewishness in different ways, explained Michael. Not by keeping kosher or going to synagogue. It is genetic, We were not very religious. My wife does not eat on Yom Kippur. I do. We always have a Passover dinner. We have a Seder. I have the recipe for gefilte fish from my grandmother. Educating Sergey. For a while, young Sergey attended the Mishkan Torah Hebrew School, but he didn't like it, and after a few years stopped going. Sergey was enrolled in the Paint Branch Montessori School in Adelphi, Maryland. He spoke English with a heavy accent when he entered the school. He didn't pick up language as quickly as the family hoped, but the bright-eyed, shy boy did adjust. His Montessori teacher, Patty Barchet, recalls, "Sergey wasn't a particularly outgoing child, but he always had the self-confidence to pursue what he had his mind on." His father gave him a Commodore 64 computer when Sergey was 9. By middle school, Sergey was recognized as a math prodigy. He went on to Eleanor Roosevelt High School in Greenbelt, Maryland, where, according to some accounts, he was cocky about his math skills, often challenging teachers on their methods and results. "I didn't systematically teach Sergey. He would ask when he wanted to know something," his father recalled. The road to Stanford. You might say Sergey went to high school, college, and graduate school at the University of Maryland. He began studying math at the college when he was 15 and quit high school altogether after his junior year to enroll full-time and graduated in 3 years. After winning a National Science Foundation scholarship, Sergey applied to several graduate schools. Being rejected by MIT wasn't such a disappointment, since he had his heart set on going to California to attend Stanford. That school appealed to him because of its proximity to Silicon Valley and the nearby army of supportive high-tech entrepreneurs. Sergey headed west to earn his PhD. He also welcomed the prospect of great weather. In California, Sergey easily took to campus social life, including skiing, rollerblading, and gymnastics. When his father asked whether he was taking any advanced classes, Sergey replied, "Yes, advanced swimming." Rajiv Motwani, one of Sergey's advisors, remembers, "He was a brash young man, but he was so smart, it just oozed out of him." Boy genius to adult genius. As an adult, Sergey is restless and edgy. His boyhood good looks and low, sloping shoulders make him seem perpetually relaxed. He is active, studying the flying trapeze at a circus school in San Francisco, except that he fell and hurt his back, and practicing springboard diving. His puckish sense of humor often grabs people off guard, and at times even comes across as juvenile. Nevertheless, his Levi's, faded t-shirt, and Crocs with socks or rollerblades are a cover for a purposeful, serious, even aggressive personality. Both Sergey and Larry are notorious workaholics. Sergey still speaks with a slight Russian accent and ends many sentences with, "and whatnot." Like Eric Schmidt and Larry Page, he overuses the word scale. Often, scale describes something that remains workable as it grows bigger. But in Google speak, it has come to mean something that can be developed into a profitable product. Wedding on a Caribbean sandbar. It seemed curious that Sergey missed Google's 2007 annual meeting, but then the story came out that may have explained it. He was getting married. Sergey's mother once expressed the hope that he would wed a nice Jewish girl, and her wish came true. He married Ann Wojcicki in May 2007 in the Bahamas. Ann's great-grandfather, on her mother's side, was a prominent Russian rabbi who came to the United States in the 1920s. With the bride wearing a white bathing suit and the groom wearing a black one, Brin and his longtime girlfriend swam to a sandbar where a friend performed the nuptials. Ann, a former healthcare analyst turned entrepreneur, is the sister of early Google executive Susan Wojcicki. The sisters grew up in Palo Alto, where their father is the head of the physics department at Stanford. Their mother is a respected journalism teacher across the street at Palo Alto High School. Anne attended Yale University, graduating in 1996 with a degree in biology. Like Sergey, she is high energy and athletic. She was a member of her college ice hockey team and a competitive ice skater. Sergey and Anne became parents for the first time in the winter of 2008 with the arrival of son Benji. 23 and Me. Google put $3.9 million into Anne Wojcicki's biotech startup 23andMe. The company is built on the concept of individualized genetic mapping. Its name refers to the number of paired chromosomes in human DNA. Anne's company can tell you about your genetic origins, your propensity or resistance to certain diseases, and scores of other intimate details. After submitting to genetic testing by 23andMe, Brin learned he has a propensity for Parkinson's disease, a condition that affects his mother. In his blog, Sergey wrote, "This leaves me in a rather unique position. I now have the opportunity to adjust my life to reduce those odds. I also have the opportunity to perform and support research into the disease long before it may affect me." He added, "I feel fortunate to be in this position. Until the fountain of youth is discovered, all of us will have some conditions in our old age, only we don't know what they will be. I have a better guess than almost anyone else for what ills may be mine, and have decades to prepare for it." Brin, along with his parents, contributed $1.5 million to the University of Maryland's Parkinson's Disease Research Project, and he also is involved with the Michael J. Fox Foundation. Anne Brin appeared on the Oprah Winfrey Show and talked about her pregnancy and the baby. "I looked at Sergey's profile, and I looked at me, and we saw that the child has a 50% chance of being lactose intolerant. Because of Sergey, the child has a very, very unlikely chance of having blue eyes." Warren Buffett did a 23andMe DNA test with musician Jimmy Buffett to resolve the long-standing question of whether they are related or not. The report came back and it said, "If you don't understand the results, give us a call." I did call and got Anne on the phone. She explained it again and asked if I understood it now. I really didn't. She finally said, "Let's put it this way. I'm more closely related to Jimmy Buffett than you are." Flying high. Sergey Brin's mother marvels at the height of her son's success. "It's mind-boggling," says Eugenia. "It's hard to comprehend, really. He was a very capable child in math and computers, but we could never imagine this." When asked how it felt to have sudden vast wealth, Brin said, "It takes a lot of getting used to. You always hear the phrase, money doesn't buy you happiness, but I always, in the back of my mind, figured a lot of money will buy you a little bit of happiness. But it's not really true. I got a new car because the old one's lease expired. Nothing terribly fancy. You could drive the same car." Has success and wealth changed him? "I don't think at a certain scale it matters," said Sergey. "But I do have a pretty good toy budget now. I just got a new monitor." Sergey also bought a pricey new home on the peninsula south of San Francisco and a New York apartment, but he still is careful with personal money. "From my parents, I learned to be frugal and to be happy without many things." He likes to shop at Costco warehouse stores, where he bought his parents a membership. "It's a store that he knows and understands," explains Sergey's father. "Luckily, there is a Costco very near Google headquarters." Larry Page, the intellectual of the Google guys, seeks exploration of space through his involvement in the Google Lunar XPRIZE and by serving on the XPRIZE board. However, Sergey, the trapeze artist, dives right in. Recently, he traveled to Kazakhstan to visit the Baikonur Cosmodrome for a mini space vacation. Brin has paid $5 million to travel into actual space. He'll make the trip in 2011 with Space Adventures, a company that struck a deal with the Russian space agency to launch the first entirely private flight into space. Brin will get one of the two seats available on that mission. Larry Page. While Sergey Brin's is an immigrant's story, Larry Page, several generations away from the immigrant experience, was in most ways the typical American boy of his generation. Even so, as with Sergey, the seeds were planted early for him to pull the Prince Arthur sword from the stone of technology. Although perhaps not consciously on the part of their parents, they both were groomed from childhood for the journey they would take. Their destiny evolved from their origins. Like his partner, Sergey Brin, Larry comes from Jewish heritage. Page's maternal grandfather immigrated to Israel, where he lived in a desert town near the Dead Sea and worked as a tool and dye maker. Larry's mother was raised in the Jewish faith, but his father was too scientific for much religion. His focus was on the world of technology. Cradled in a computer culture. Page's grandfather was a Detroit factory worker, but his grandson has had a far different life. Lawrence Edward Page grew up in Lansing, Michigan, surrounded by math, science, and computers. His father was a highly regarded professor at Michigan State, where his mother also taught computer programming. His parents divorced when Larry was 8 years old. Nevertheless, the boy grew up with both parents in his life. Larry's fun-loving father took him to Grateful Dead concerts as a child. Page explained, "My dad was a computer science professor, so he had computers really early. The first computer we owned as a family was in 1978. Larry would have been 5 years old. The Exidy Sorcerer. It was popular in Europe, but never in the U.S. It had 32K memory. My brother had to write the operating system." Larry inherited at least one of his father's traits, the tendency to have spirited discussions about everything. "In some ways, Carl was a little hard to deal with," said George Stockman, one of Professor Page's colleagues at Michigan State, "because he wanted to argue about everything, and he did, and he shared a lot of that with his son. So intellectually, they shared in a lot of discussion." Nikola Tesla, Page's hero. 12-year-old Larry Page, an aspiring inventor, read a biography of Nikola Tesla, and it got him to thinking. The boy admired the phenomenal number of innovations created by Tesla, but was struck by the fact that Tesla led a life fraught with conflict, was bad with money, died in poverty, and was little known outside scientific circles. Certainly, schoolchildren don't study Tesla the way they do Thomas Edison. Considered the father of modern physics and electrical engineering, Tesla invented alternating current, AC power, and the AC motor. He pioneered many scientific advances, including robotics, remote control, radar, and computer science. Although Marconi claimed it, Tesla was eventually recognized as the inventor of the radio. His workable inventions aside, Tesla often was regarded as a mad scientist, thanks to his behavior and a raft of wild ideas. Tesla also had difficulty commercializing or finding practical applications for his ideas and inventions, and therefore did not seem to accomplish as much as he might have. Page dreamed of being as creative and doing such great things, and he wanted his work to make a difference and change the world. Since some of Tesla's inventions did change the world, it would also seem that even at 12 years of age, Page was also aiming for recognition and financial reward. Tesla's story. In 1856, Nikola Tesla, according to legend, was born exactly at midnight during a raging electric storm, which may or may not explain his troubled life and his fascination with anything that sparked. Tesla, a Croatian, studied in several respected Eastern European universities, but despite his genius, never graduated. He experienced a nervous breakdown in early life, but nevertheless found work in the emerging electrical power industry. When he immigrated to the United States, he went to work for Thomas Edison, but left Edison after an argument over wages. Soon, Tesla was off doing his own research and working on inventions in New York and Colorado Springs. The appeal of Colorado was the wonderful electric storms of the Rocky Mountains. Visitors to Tesla's laboratories often found him at work, surrounded by man-made lightning. Although Tesla assured them the lightning bolts were harmless, the sight terrified the visitors. Certainly, Tesla was quirky, most likely suffering from an obsessive-compulsive disorder. He was fanatically clean, had an aversion to overweight people, and became obsessed with the number 3. He often circled the block 3 times before entering a building, demanded 3 napkins at a meal, and would not stay in a hotel unless the room was divisible by the number 3. Tesla may have suffered from a rare neurological condition called synesthesia, in which one type of stimulation evokes the sensation of another. For example, hearing a sound or thinking of a number may produce the visualization of a color. The inventor died alone and penniless at age 86 in room 3327 of the New Yorker Hotel. The Tesla car. Despite his tragic story, Tesla has many admirers, one of whom named an uber-chic $109,000 electric sports car after him. The limited run of hand-built Teslas will travel up to 130 miles per hour and do 0 to 60 in about 4 seconds. The Tesla also can go 250 miles on a single charge of electricity to its nearly silent motor. The car is powered by an innovative lithium-ion battery and costs a penny a mile to drive. The car's developers chose to build a sports version because they knew the first generation of their car would be expensive due to development costs. They also realized that many of Silicon Valley's billionaires pay homage to green technology and simple living, but also have a yen for fast cars. They have Corvettes, Porsches, and other costly sports cars tucked away in the 5-car garage. They figured a whiz-bang electric model would have appeal. During the economic crisis of 2008, Tesla Motors ran into financial trouble and has had to cut back drastically. But thanks to $40 million from an angel investor, it has been able to carry on. By the end of 2008, Tesla had orders for more than 1,200 cars and had delivered 50 Roadsters. It was shipping 10 cars a week. Both Larry and Sergey have ordered the Tesla, as have actor George Clooney and California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. Motivated by Montessori. Like Sergey, Larry attended a Montessori elementary school where he was exposed to an educational method developed by an Italian physician, Maria Montessori, in the early 1920s. Her ideas quickly spread around the world. Montessori once wrote, "There is a part of a child's soul that has always been unknown, but which must be known. With the spirit of sacrifice and enthusiasm, we must go in search, like those who travel to foreign lands and tear up mountains in their search for hidden gold." Montessori believed that children wanted to learn and that development came in stages with each child. Playing was children's work, and by directed play, children moved along with their phases of development into deep learning. As a result, children often became more self-managing, responsible, and committed to lifelong learning. Certainly, her methods seem to have shaped both Sergey and Larry. "We do not want children who simply obey and are there without interest," she taught, "but we want to help them in their mental and emotional growth. Therefore, we should not try to give small ideas, but great ones, so that they not only receive them, but ask for more." The Leadership Program. Later, Larry Page graduated from East Lansing High School, where he played the saxophone. He went on to graduate with honors and a degree in computer engineering from the University of Michigan. At UM, he served a term as president of Eta Kappa Nu, the National Honor Society for Electrical and Computer Engineering Students. There, and in another special program, he began developing leadership skills. In particular, he said, the Leader Shape program was an amazing experience that helped me a lot when we started Google. LeaderShape is a UM personal development program that originated in the early 1990s in the College of Engineering. The Solar Race. It also was at the University of Michigan that Larry followed his interest in alternative forms of energy. As a member of the school's solar car team, he took part in the early phase of building the champion 1993 Maize and Blue Solar Car. The UM Solar Car ran in two races, winning a national championship in Sun Race 93, the predecessor race to the North American Solar Challenge. It then went on to finish 11th in the 1993 World Solar Challenge. Maize and Blue is now part of the permanent display at the Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago. The car had an evolutionary design descended from the General Motors Sunracer and the University of Michigan's first-generation car, Sunrunner. It is considered an early demonstration of energy-efficient automobile design. Go West, Larry. After earning his undergraduate degree, Larry headed for Stanford University. However, having spent his entire life in the familiar environment around Michigan, he set out to California with some trepidation. "At first it was pretty scary," he said. "I kept complaining to my friends that I was going to get sent home on the bus. It didn't quite happen that way, however."
Tragedy struck during Larry's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.